over to Mr. Anup Pujari from CDR India. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today on Jindal Stainless Limited's Investor and Analyst Conference call to discuss the merger of Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited into the company. We have with us Mr. Abhyuday Jindal, Managing Director of the company, Mr. Anurag Mantri, Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Gautam Chakraborty, Head Investor Relations, and Mr. Navneet Raghuvanshi, Company Secretary of the company. We will begin the call with brief opening remarks from the management, following which we'll have the forum open for an interactive question and answer session. Before we start, I would like to point out that some statements made in today's call may be forward-looking in nature, and a disclaimer to this effect has been included in the presentation that was shared with you earlier. I would now like to invite Mr. Abhyuday Jindal to make his opening remarks.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the management team of Jindal Stainless Limited, I welcome you all to our investor and analyst conference call. This call follows the key decision we took in our board meeting on December 29, 2020. As most of you are aware that the company's board had earlier constituted a committee to explore and evaluate various options of consolidating of the businesses of Jindal Stainless Limited and Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited and or other group entities. I am very happy to share that the committee has recommended merging JSHL into JSL, subject to shareholders and regulatory approvals effective from 1st April 2020. This would be a major milestone for our group, and I will start the session by sharing my perspective on the proposed merger and then hand it over to Anurag, who will take you through the details of the scheme. Post the merger, the combined entity will collectively have a total melting capacity of 1.9 million tons per annum. With this, the entity will become the first Indian multinational company to enter the league of top 10 global stainless steel manufacturers by capacity. The increased scale of the combined entity will offer significant financial and operational synergistic opportunities that will play out over the medium to long term. JSL's close proximity to port and raw materials, coupled with JSHL's strategically located facility in key consumption centers, is also expected to enhance operational synergies. Overall, we expect the single listed entity to register higher efficiencies in various aspects of the entire business operations. We believe one of the key synergies of the merger include a strategic fit of the future growth potential of both companies. JSL's Jajpur plant is well equipped with surplus land, world-class infrastructure, and substantial potential to undergo cost-efficient brownfield expansion. Therefore, there exists a considerable reinvestment opportunity to unlock future growth. As most of you closely tracking our company are aware, that JSL is largely focused on high-volume stainless steel offerings and has been actively catering to sectors like railway, architecture, auto, and infrastructure. On the other hand, JSHL is focused on high-margin specialized product division and has been actively catering to value-added segments, such as precision strips, razor blade, coin blanks, and other niche offerings. Therefore, the combined entity will have 360-degree diversified product portfolio of over 120-plus grades with unique synergy of both volumes and value offerings to cater to the ever-growing demand from the ABC, auto railway, and SPD segments. A stronger global footprint through JSL's international service centers, finishing lines, and extensive pan-India network through JSHL service centers will further strengthen the just-in-time approach through a single window customer service. Furthermore, we are confident that consolidation of experienced talent along with the R&D wing and modern state-of-the-art facilities will create an optimal ecosystem to strengthen the overall innovative culture within the organization. So, overall, we are very excited about the unique opportunities this merger will create for our overall business growth. The company would continue to aim for greater synergies while aspiring to maximize value for all our stakeholders. With this, I will now hand over to Anurag, who will take us through the details of the proposed merger transaction. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhyuday. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and warm welcome to everyone for joining us the call today. I will briefly take you through the overall highlights of the proposed merger. Pursuant to this scheme, JSHL will get amalgamated into JSL along with all its subsidiaries and investments. The entire valuation exercise has been conducted by independent valuer. After analyzing the various methods of valuation, scheme fairness opinion on the valuation, and the swap ratio has been issued by SBI Cap as a merchant banker. As per the scheme, JSHL will merge into JSL, leading to a single entity, single legal entity going forward, which is JSL. Transaction between the two entities in all equity merger, shareholders of Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited shall be issued equity shares of Jindal Stainless Limited in the ratio of 1:1.95. Upon merger being effective, the promoters holding promoters will hold 57.1% stake on a fully diluted basis in the combined entity, while the remaining 42.9% will be held by the shareholders in the combined entity. We strongly believe that the proposed merger will consolidate the complementing strength of both JSL and JSHL, as explained by Abhyuday. And this will provide a great opportunity for unlocking the value for all the stakeholders in future. The transaction is subject to approval of by JSL, JSHL shareholder and receipt of various regulatory approval, and is expected to close by H2 of FY 2022. As a combined entity, we will have a pro forma top line of around 20,000 crore on 12 months ended March 2020. And EBITDA of around 2,000 crore in, at a pro forma entity level on March 31, 2020. We expect to derive significant synergies from growth and process efficiencies, which would go in a long way in assisting our performance. I would also like to highlight that the arrangement would make it a single listed entity and a simplified capital structure, along with elimination of cross-holdings and intercompany balances. And a strong balance sheet and improving leverage ratio will provide adequate financial flexibility to the company for the future growth. As Abhyuday mentioned, the combination of JSL and JSHL is a compelling business proposition and will benefit all the stakeholders. This concludes my remark on the transaction. Details of the transaction details of this merger. I would now request moderator to open the lines for the Q&A session.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Amit Dixit from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon and thanks for taking my question. First of all, congratulations for achieving the board approval for merger within the timeline stipulated in previous earnings call. I have a couple of questions. The first one is on the steps after this. Do you foresee any regulatory hurdles from either Competition Commission or shareholders of JSHL? And if you can break the timelines, particularly the regulatory ones, until H2FY22. So that is the first question.
Okay, Amit, this is Anurag here. So overall, obviously, it will go through a regulatory approval process, which includes primarily the SEBI approval, include the shareholders' approval of both the companies, as well as the NCLT approval. Some of the process will overlap, but mostly it will start after the SEBI approval, and also there is a critical lender's approval in between. So all these will put together, if you see, we expect this to be closed by March 2022. That's what the trading permission we expect of the one listed entity which should emerge. Now, obviously, that entity will have their own process of approval, so we really cannot comment on what kind of thing they will connect. But I think from our side, we have done this exercise completely in an independent way. And this has been done by the third-party independent advisor. So hopefully, I think it should be more synergistic than keeping in mind of the larger synergies to create a larger entity. It should be in the right direction.
No, in particular, since you will be controlling now 50% or a little bit above that market share in India, so is there any possibility of hurdle from Competition Commission?
Okay, from CCI perspective, we have already taken a clear opinion because both of the companies belong to the same promoter group. So, and we believe that because from CCI perspective, there should not be any issues. And this is a very clear opinion. We don't have to go for CCI approval because though the companies are operating in a different way, but I think because the main promoter shareholders were of the same group, so we don't see perceive any of the challenges from CCI perspective.
Great, that's good to know. The second question is on synergy. Is it possible to quantify some of those synergies? And I know the broad areas where they fall, but if you can quantify, that would be great. And are there any plans of issuing pro forma combined financial statements for Q2 FY21 and FY20 for the final entity?
So maybe synergy, I will say, give few of the thing. But before that, let me answer your second question on pro forma financial. Probably we will give pro forma financial on the full year basis because we just announced this merger. I think FY20 we have already given pro forma numbers, so those are there. FY21, yes, we will try to endeavor at least give the pro forma entities numbers.
So
and those will be the detailed statements, right?
Sorry?
Full balance sheet.
It will not be detailed because both companies will continue to work independently till the time merger is approved by the regulatory authority. So and it will continue to work as a two separate listed entity. So we will not be publishing the statutory numbers of this, but yes, we will give you the pro forma P&L.
Okay.
So on synergies, maybe.
Yeah, on synergies, basically, Amit, there are synergies are going to happen across the whole pie. You know, operationally, financially, we are going to become one of the biggest stainless steel companies in the world. So being with revenue of 20,000 plus crores, you know, our strengths are going to increase in negotiating with everyone in all our contracts that we do in the future. Logistics, purchasing, with the banks, our rating should improve. So there are going to be a lot of synergies from the financial strength point of view. Operationally also, we are at the moment very tough to give you a figure because that is exactly what we are working on. Each department is working on exactly how do we, whatever we had to split when we were going for this whole asset monetization plan. And now that we are merging the companies again, whatever we had to split, whatever regulations we had to incur at that time, now we are all rolling them back. So it's a little tough to give you a value right now, but there are going to be tremendous synergies across the board.
Okay, great. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jamesh Sankvi from Principal Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. So, couple of things. One is, what would be the likely combined capex, maintenance capex, and the annual capex over and above the growth capex for this entity? And what is the average interest cost right now at both these entities, and how should one look at it going ahead? Because probably there could be renegotiations which could also happen on the bank front. Considering the cash flows and the balance sheet strength that comes up. So if you can just share the current details for these things.
Sure, I mean, so capex-wise, FY21 estimated capex is in the range of, say, around 300 to 350 crore range combined put together, both the entities, which includes the normal maintenance capex
and sustenance
capex, and some of the even the future capex, which was primarily of SPT division of GSHL. Now, going forward, yes, I think we are working on how all our various expansion plan, keeping in mind our balance sheet strength. That I think we will probably for FY22, we will probably once we finalize, we will surely share the details for this. But FY21, we don't expect more than 350 crore, around 350 crore sort of total capex between these two entities. Your second question was on the interest part of the both the entities. Now, absolutely yes. Means with the combined entity, we will have a we should improve our rating in overall on a joint basis. And that will bring the good synergies into this. We already started the discussions with the various lenders, and currently the if I see the long-term debt cost is close to around 11% in the entity, which is expected to come down to close to less than 12.5% in the near future. Overall interest cost basis, if I look at this year, it's FY21. As compared to FY20 interest cost, we should have at least 10 to 15% saving on the interest cost.
Okay. So you said the average cost is 11% right now for the combined entity, and that could come down to 10.5%.
Yes, less than 10.5%, I would say.
Okay. And the interest cost overall on a combined basis could reduce by 15 to 20%. So this is largely because of the adjustment of the intercorporate loan or...
I'm saying excluding yes intercorporate loan because that is anyway right now till the time companies will function it will continue to be booked separately on nine and in so one side it will book as a GSSL will continue to book as that interest as other income while GSL will continue to book as an interest income so that will appear as it is. The number I have shared with you the interest cost reduction of 10 to 15% is excluding of that. That because that will remain as it is the number. Also, we are targeting a accelerated debt reduction even in this year. So with combined entity, if I put it together, excluding of this 900 crore, we expect to less than 3,700 crore debt in this both the entities together.
So that would be, so currently you have mentioned that 4,700 is the net debt, right, in your presentation for the combined entity.
Yes.
So that is as on FY20?
That was FY20 and by FY21 our target is to bring it to less than 3,700 crore, excluding of 900 crore debt.
Okay. So as a combined entity, it would be 3,700 by March 21. Excluding these?
That is our target to that. I think we are working towards it.
And what's the repayment schedule for FY22?
So, post this, if we achieve this accelerated debt reduction plan in this year, the repayment during next year will be approximate between the two entity is going to be around, say, 250 crore.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all.
The next question is from the line of Nirbhar Mahawar from N Square Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Just wanted to understand the demand perspective. What kind of production, maximum production, existing capacities can produce and when do we see CAPEX next phase of expansion taking place? Let's say a medium term and longer term CAPEX.
So currently our total volume that the merged entity will have is 1.9 million tons. This year obviously because of Q1 being a completely closed that time, we will obviously not be meeting that target. We'll be reaching about 1.35, 1.4 for this year. And CAPEX plan we're currently working on. We see demand coming in. We see a lot of growth coming in stainless steel sector. So currently, we are working on our CAPEX plans. And I think we should be announcing that soon as well. So just give us a little more time, another month or something, because we see the demand coming in. We see a requirement for brownfield expansion as well. So we're just working on exactly our CAPEX plan for the next 2 years.
So let's say if I take a little longer term, this thing, let's say 3 years from now, would it be fair to assume that our volumes will be more than 3 million ton?
Yes, if things are continue to perform the way they are and market stays bullish, commodity prices stay bullish, then definitely within 3 years, we can increase by another million tons, you can say.
And what kind of capex that would be required?
Capex that would be required for this, because we will need to go for the complete sort of brownfield expansion, but it will be at a fraction of our initial investment. So it will be to the tune of 2,000 to 2,500 will be the capex required to increase Odisha by double capacity in Odisha, basically.
So another 1.1 million ton expansion in Odisha. You think 1.1 or 1.9?
One million ton.
For another 1 million ton would require 2,000 crore of.
Approximate 2,000 to 2,500 crore in over next 2 years time frame.
2 to 3 years, this will be required.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashav Rakesh Patel from India SME Investment. Please go ahead.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
First question is that promoter shareholding will be 57% post restructuring. So how does the management plan to increase that shareholding and take it towards 70-75%? And what would be the process of doing it? Would it be open market purchases, preferential share allotment, or warrants?
See, let me answer. I think currently there's no plan as such to increase the shareholding at this level, because we are focusing right now with the with this merger coming as a more strategic thing. As Abhijit mentioned, I think we'll be focusing more on expansion plan. So, and we will announce as and when we go in the future plan. But yes, right now there is no immediate plan which has been approved by board or anybody for further increase of the shareholding.
Okay. And we have observed that whenever companies declare dividend after a multi-year gap, and markets take it very positively because it indicates that management is willing to share the profits with minority shareholders. And given that shareholders in GSL have not earned anything in past 15 years, so how do you plan to declare dividend, and what would be the timeline for the same?
Yes, combined entity, we would like to, because now as an organization and as a company, we have decided, you know, to take care of all our stakeholders, minority, majority shareholders, everybody. So this year, combined entity, I think around September, October, if things go well, then...
Combined entity will come into play once the approval of combined entity is...
Only after that we can...
Only approve. After that we will be able to...
Okay.
So we do have plans, but only once the merger is completed, then we will announce.
Okay. And last question is that as per the note by IDBI, JSL was, so what they mentioned was that by March 21, announcement is going to come of increase of 0.5 million ton capacity, and that would be at capex cost of 500 or 600 crores. So I wanted to understand that why the difference is drastic compared to the any greenfield capacity. So it is given that we already have an excess land bank, but apart from that, how are we getting benefited when we are doing brownfield capex?
So basically, when we were setting up this Odisha facility, we had already made all the provisions for doubling it from 1 million to 2 million tons. You know, so that's why our capex at that time was very high, and that is another reason why during the same time we went under trouble, was because we made all provisions. So civil work has been completed. It is pretty much just buying the equipment and placing the equipment. That is all that we need to do, which is why it will be happen at a fraction of the cost.
Okay. Thank you. And last question is pertaining to the statement which you earlier also mentioned that you plan to develop that Jajpur as a stainless steel hub. So where are we on the front? Any further land procurement or anything?
So land procurement is in process. That is the only area that is sort of getting delayed, where I would say, because again, it is totally dependent on the state government. But that is in our plans to take up next year as well, to create that SF park is going to be around 200 to 300 acre park that we're going to create, and hopefully we are able to start the work in FY in next year.
Sure. All the very best. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ritika Gupta from Equitas Investment. Please go ahead.
Hello. Congratulations to the entire team on walking the talk. So I wanted to know for the CAPEX, to increase it from 1.1 million tons in JSL to 2 million tons is what's going to cost you 2,500 crores, 2,000 to 2,500 crores, or to increase it from 1.1 to 3 million tons?
What Abhijit mentioned is increasing another million tons will cost approximately 2,500, but I think just wait, because these are preliminary estimates. I think let us firm up our plan, and obviously once we firm up our plan, we'll obviously share with the larger shareholder. And having said that, I think we again want to reiterate that all this will be again the prudent financial discipline. So we'll continue to focus on our balance sheet strength.
Okay, and typically once you announce this CAPEX, how much time would it take to commence production from there?
It takes about, you can say, between 18 to 24 months.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sunil Jain from Nirmal Bang Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir, and congratulations for this merger announcement. Sir, my question is just to get a clarification about the debt what you had sent by the end of this March 21 of 3,700. So, are we targeting reduction of debt of around 1,000 crore in the current year combined entity?
Yes, we are targeting at least 1,100 crore to 1,200 crore reduction in this year. So which will be some of the scheduled repayment, plus we are also targeting an accelerated repayment of the debt to further improve our balance sheet.
Okay, and that totally from our internal cash generation.
Yes, all this has been targeted through largely through internal approval. The internal approval, where I'm saying net debt reduction. So there could be some debt replacement which could happen, but overall, yes, the debt book will reduce by at least 1,100 to 1,200 crore this year.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, thanks for this. And apart from this, can you just talk about the current scenario of the stainless steel market and what is the impact of that, whatever the anti-subsidy which was put up, was there any benefit of that is accruing to the company or not?
So, in terms of the market, stainless steel, we've seen a V-shaped recovery after this pandemic or after the whole lockdown Q1, Q2 scenario. So, we've definitely seen a V-shaped recovery. All sectors of ours other than railway is actually growing. So, auto, utensils, industrial, pipe and tube, every segment of ours, we've seen good growth, good demand coming in from the domestic market. And what was your second question, sorry?
The impact of the anti-CVD that was put up by the government.
Nothing has not been approved till now. That is still with the ministries. There was an interim CVD that was approved in September. So that only had a nominal impact on imports coming in from Indonesia. But that is also interim. It was levied for 6 months. We are expecting final CVD to come within the next 1 or 2 months, but the impact was only on reduction of imports coming in from Indonesia. Imports from other countries are still coming in from China, Europe, Korea, Japan is still continuing.
So, but the realization seems to be on an upper trend.
Yes.
Okay. Great, sir. Yeah, thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vishal Chandak from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Thank you, and congratulations for the merger announcement. My first question is with respect to how do you look at the sustainable EBITDA for the combined entity going forward?
Vishal, your question is about how will we sustain the EBITDA going forward, right, as a business?
No, no, sir. My question was what do you target as a sustainable EBITDA through the cycle on the consolidated entity?
See, obviously, as we ramp up the volume, we expect sustainable EBITDA in this combined entity EBITDA per ton should be in the range of, say, maybe 13,000 to 15,000 ton range. This year, it could be, probably we could have it into 14,000 to 15,000 range, but there's even, there could be some years of the downside, but at least we expect, we'll endeavor to have at least 13,000 to 15,000 per ton EBITDA range on a combined entity basis.
Great. My second question was with respect to the treatment of the intercorporate loan and the investment of JSHL in JSL's equity. So while arriving at this swap ratio, how have we considered these two items?
See, Vishal, this entire valuation exercise has been done very independently by the independent valuer. And they have detailed analysis of each and every aspect of both the companies and strengths and all this thing. And then they have arrived to a valuation methodology, which has been then independently also vetted by SBI Capital Markets as a merchant banker. And then it has been presented to our independent committee of the board of directors and then went to board of directors. It has gone through a very rigorous process of very independent exercise to that. Now, I think the valuation methodology, broadly what will happen, the entire holding will get cancelled and even intercorporate deposit will also, balances will also get cancelled into this process. But also, if you ask this, I think all the stocks, because both companies are well traded stocks in terms of even more than getting traded with the normal threshold of the normal daily trading volume to the market cap. This is what independent valuers have presented that. And since all this is in a public domain, very transparently as asset and registered as asset liabilities of the various respected countries, so that accordingly has been considered in this process.
Sure, thanks. So if I may squeeze in one question, this is with respect to the Jindal Lifestyle that you have demerged out of JSL Lifestyle. What are the growth plans for that entity? I understand that would be focused on non-railways downstream stainless steel business. So what are the growth plans?
The focus for Lifestyle is always going to be on the consumer-driven businesses. You know, so that is our consumer facing arm and we want to actually leverage that further. So we wanted to separate the mobility, which is more industrial OEM B2B business, from our B2C business. So Lifestyle will focus on hollowware, on tableware products, on kitchens, plumbing, OEM business, like it supplies to Whirlpool. We're adding further other OEMs into the fold, like Havells, LG, certain other ones we're adding. So it's going to focus completely on the consumer-driven business of stainless steel.
Sure. Any particular targets for that particular business over there, or we're still working on that?
Targets in terms of?
Revenue, EBITDA, or any plans to list it in the future?
So no investment currently. We still have capacity that we can leverage out of it. And that is the first goal, is to reach 100% capacity utilization.
Sure. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepak Mehta, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yes. Hello.
Yes.
Very nice step by the company. So my question is already asked. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, Deepak.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saket Kapoor from Kapoor & Company. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. And thank you for the opportunity. And, sir, congratulations to the team for doing whatever has been committed to investors at large and in an industry-related time frame. Sir, as the earlier speakers mentioned about the Jindal lifestyle part, that I think is housed currently under Hisar. So we would like to know, sir, that this entity was earlier being showcased as one of the more Jindal listed would have come up in the listed space through Hisar, and the Hisar shareholders would have got benefited out of the listing going forward. But now, as everything is coming into one fold, what steps are you could be taken to reward the shareholders before this this entity gets again folded up into JSL?
Saket, as we mentioned, this all this aspects have been considered by the independent valuer and merchant bankers and gone through that process. If you see in this part of the scheme, there were two part of the business of lifestyle, and as Abhita mentioned, this we are splitting this business and only want to remain focused in this entity and the team of this entity to be focusing on the consumer-facing business, which includes the retail, infra, plumbing, OEM sort of businesses, and the railway, which has a more synergy with the JSL and JSSL sort of parent business, will get merged under that particular team in that, so that we don't have a duplications of the efforts in the both the entities. So, and since all the console results and everything are well published in the public domain, so they have considered, independent valuers have considered all the aspects in that fashion.
Sir, I could.
And it will be obviously because first our target is to take this entity to a reasonable level of this thing, because currently it is still quite small in terms of the play, and still the we have the reach to a capacity utilization and all this. So it requires further efforts into this entity.
Yes, sir. It is correct. Not to dwell more into it, but my point was, since this was housed under Hisar, and it was considered to be one of a very unique proposition of consumer facing part of the stainless steel business of the Jindal Group. So, as the existing investors of Hisar had something been carved out, and we would have received something from this proposition, and when the listing would have happened 3-4 years down the line, the value creation would have been done. But now everything will get folded up into one entity, JSL. That was my short point I was trying to make.
Thank you for your point, I think. So the detail, as Saket we mentioned, is that
it has been done, but had this been this aspect been looked into, valuation would have been done, sir. That's all, sir.
Saket, I would say
we looked at everything, and as a promoter, we have done absolutely with fair valuers, SBI Cash, Transaction Square. It was not through our opinion. We as promoters are not benefiting anywhere from it. So it is completely done at a dispassionate level as an organization. That is the way we perform. You know, we're not going to manipulate and manage anything. That is a clear direction given to everybody. And jo nikal ke aaya tha from the market price approach, that is what we have gone ahead with.
You know? Absolutely, sir. Yes, sir.
Take that in the right spirit.
Correct, sir. And we hope for a good value creation going forward.
Yes, it should create a lot of value, this combined entity. Please believe me. You know, this swap ratio is a very minor, small thing. This combined entity for all investors, shareholders, is going to create tremendous value. That is the vision. Please stay with the company, believe in us. We're going to achieve it.
Right, sir. And, sir, lastly, the point about the business environment, sir. Earlier, sir, it was these combined entity only, but the business environment, saring that we need to recast depth and do away with two different companies. So, sir, how have the changes, what are the key changes that have happened in the organization under your strong leadership, that now this consolidation, reconsolidation, if I can use the term, would lead to value creation? That was my last question. Thank you. Hello?
So, I mean, Saket, this is going to be a little long discussion, but in terms of operational financial synergies, there are tremendous, like we said. Operational is what we are currently working on. Whatever we had to do
in terms of when two companies were split, all the separation, all that. Now we will roll back, we will get it into one. Our negotiating power, because being such a large entity, will improve. We will renegotiate in all our contracts, logistics, purchase, service providers, with everybody we will be renegotiating, you know. So, everywhere there will be a lot of
improvement. See, Saket, I think your question was that when Abhyuday took charge of as a MD, what are the key changes which has happened in the organization? Let me just, I think I'll be the person to answer that question rather than Abhyuday, because we are the one who have experienced it well in terms of the thing. So I can say that, and you can start seeing that in our financial, because obviously that for any changes, ultimately, the final thing which matters, how it reflects in your P&L and balance sheet. So in terms of the operational margin, you would have, I'm sure you would appreciate the kind of changes we have done in our logistics, inventory levels. So it's a long list. So it's not only one aspect, right, from sales.
Main thing, if I can add, Saket, main thing that I personally have worked on after joining the organization has been on supply chain. You know, it's been on complete supply chain from purchasing of raw materials to delivering to the end customer. So, you know, our lead times used to be very high, very long, 4 or 5 years back, and working on supply chain by buying closer to the company, buying more domestic sources, creating a whole warehousing facility that now we have so we can supply just in time to our customers. That is the main focus area that I have taken over. And we're continuing to improve on that, and tremendous improvement has been done by the team.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for all, and all the best, sir, for going forward to the entire team, sir. Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Nirbhav Mahawar from N Square Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, this is just a request to understand the profitability of company better. If you can share whenever you communicate with the investors, the cost details of any of the category. So basically what I'm trying to understand is how steady your spreads are over a longer period of time. Because you've got multiple categories in your product mix. So it is very difficult to understand the cost and selling price spread.
See, I think you have a point, but I think you also, as we shared with you, there is a very peculiarity in the stainless steel business. And as we mentioned, because we being present in all the segments and multiple product range, it gives us a very agile business model, because even if sometimes some segment is not working, we can all immediately switch our product range to different segments. That is our agility in our business model, which we have actually consciously created into that, as Abhita mentioned, the entire supply chain thing. So that actually, in a larger way, benefits to the thing. So I think as a management team, overall, what we are guiding is that overall on a blended basis, it is our commitment to deliver the EBITDA margin of almost 13,000 to 15,000 on a consistent basis. This is in a combined entity. This is what our target has been there. So that, I think, should give a good confidence for you, and leave that, because sometime like in quarter one, when domestic market was not, if I go with the mix, we could not have sold a single ton, and we could not have gone into the Europe and changed the product mix. Then immediately when the domestic recovery happened, then we immediately, and not all the segment opened up, then the segment which opened up was actually auto and railway. So we pushed all our product in that particular and managed to get a V-shaped recovery. So I think because this product has a very different peculiarity with the any other metal. So I think it's our thing is that to create a very agile business model so that we can actually cater to all the segments and all the product range. And not all the segments will be working, will be performing at all point of time, because every business has their own cyclicity. To de-risk to a large extent our business from this cyclicity. So this is our entire aim, what Vidya was also mentioning in terms of, and coming back to, I think it entire just lies in the entire supply chain so that we can actually, the faster we switch to that, cater to that, I think we'll be able to consistently perform.
So what you're saying is that a 13 to 15,000 rupee EBITDA per ton, regardless of all these cyclical fluctuations, looks reasonably achievable.
Yes, that's what our target may be.
Yeah, because you have got a conversion, ideally, I mean, in a conversion business with a dominant market share, that kind of spread should be very much possible.
Yes, it is. It is exactly like you're saying, because of the segments and because of the huge mix of grades that we have and all the markets available to us, definitely it is achievable.
Yeah, but I would again reiterate that just to get a sense on costing better, if you can share any particular series cost details, that would be really, really helpful. Just give a thought over it.
Oh, you know, honestly, I cannot do that because we don't know if our competitors are on this call, and that is something.
So I'm not looking at in this call. Whenever you think it is appropriate, if you can share it.
Okay. Thanks. I'll discuss with the team. If they find it appropriate, then we will do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Devang Sanghvi from ICICI Direct. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity and congrats on the proposed consolidation. My question is regarding the railway segment. Does the combined entity will have higher products for the railway segment? Because even we are transferring one business. So can you specify some areas out there, which particular vertical are looking in terms of wagons and other things, bridges and other things?
What will be the percentage you are asking, or
percentage also, and secondly, any new areas which you will target for the combined entity? Any?
So railway, see, the good thing about our organization is that we are not totally or very heavily dependent on any particular segment. So if you see, railway for us is about 13 to 15%. Auto is about 10 to 12. Pipe and tube is about 15%. You know, so all segments of ours are in the range of 10 to 20%, I would say. So any cyclicity that happens in one segment, we can always pick up our sales in the other segment. That is a very good flexibility that we have within the organization. Any new areas that you are saying to target, the only new area, because we are anyway present in all the segments where the industry is consumed, the only one new area which has already been about a year and a half, which we've entered, is defense and aerospace. So there we further want to expand and grow our portfolio as well. That is possibly the only area from a new segment perspective where we're going to target. But otherwise, in all our other segments, either we want to consolidate further or increase our market share.
Right. And this particular new area, defense and aerospace, would they have higher margins as compared to the blended margin? That is the right assumption.
So volume will still be less because if you are following, country is still opening up for defense sector and most of it, we are still competing with imports.
Like
but as and when it increases, as and when our country opens up further, then it will have a direct impact on the volumes and EBITDA. But till now, because it's a very small part of the whole pie, it's not going to create a major impact.
But it will be a growing opportunity in the future. That's a good assumption to take.
A growing opportunity, that's why we have already entered that segment. And we're getting good traction, good orders.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir, and all the best, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Devam.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of VP Rajesh from Banyan Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Just wanted to understand what is the current capacity utilization on a consolidated basis.
So current capacity, we are almost reaching 100% now because there is good demand we are seeing from all segments. So you can say that we are at practically 100%.
So as Abhijit mentioned, that year we expect to close with our approximate 1.4 million tons put together because the quarter one was a very low casting volume. So. Approximate 1.4 is the what we are targeting in the year.
Okay, and then what is the expansion plan in the next year? Are you already thinking about expanding capacities?
So we are working on that exactly as we speak.
and we do plan to do some capex in the next, I won't say in the next 1 year, but within the next 3 years, we definitely do plan to do some capex expansion, and most of that will happen in Orissa, in JSL Jashpur.
Okay, all right, thank you so much. That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference back to the management for their closing comments.
Thank you. I would like to again thank everyone for attending this call and for showing interest in Jindal Stainless Limited. The fundamental aim of this merger is to primarily register synergies on operations and processes. Post-merger, the entity will have a large Indian MNC with a strong global footprint, truly representing government's vision of Make in India, Atmanirbhar Bharat. Overall, the company remains positive that its strong positioning in the stainless steel industry and improving macros would help it deliver steady and consistent growth going forward. I hope we have been able to answer all your questions. Should you need any further clarification or would like to know more about the company, please feel free to contact our investor relations team or Citygate. Thank you once again for taking the time to join us on this call. Wish you all a very happy and healthy new year. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Jindal Stainless Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.